structure of the panel of the scripture here, verses 4 to 9, and we'll deal with this quickly. You stress the thing that you mentioned first you're stressing, and the thing you mentioned last you're stressing. That's the way discourse works. So when you start a paragraph off, you have a topic sentence, don't you? And when you get to the end of your paragraph, you conclude it, don't you? And the point is in the conclusion, it better be. Otherwise people are not going to get it. Does that make sense? So it's primary stress, right at the beginning, prior stress, and end stress. Here's what Paul's got to say. I always thank my God for you because of his grace given you in Christ Jesus. The significant thing about you, he says, is the grace of God has been given you in Christ. Then he goes on and he says, oh, in him you've been enriched in every way with all kinds of speech, with all knowledge, God thus confirming our testimony about Christ among you. Therefore you do not lack any spiritual gift as you eagerly wait for the Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. Are any of those things in the stress position? No. But what's in the stress position is that he will also keep you firm to the end so that you'll be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Look, the Corinthian church, what we know about them from the rest of the epistle, is that they think they're big, important and significant because they've been enriched in their speech, in their knowledge and with every spiritual gift. And those things are important. But they are the things they make the big thing. And Paul's saying the big thing, the stress thing, is this. He's given his grace to you, and God is faithful, who called you into fellowship with him. The other things follow are important. But the big deal is that you've been called into the fellowship with his Son by the grace of God. And God is faithful. Paul is going to go through a bush backwards with these people in the remaining chapters of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. There's tough stuff to be done. There's hard stuff to be done. It's going to be a battle along the way. People are going to get hurt, beaten up, fall out, stressed out with Paul, fed up with him. As he's trying to say, guys, we can't go on behaving like this. We turned from sin and trusted Jesus, remember? But first of all, his pastoral, that's his theological purpose, is to put it right. But his pastoral purpose is to secure them so that they can then deal with the difficult stuff. Does that make sense? Can you see the line of argument? He's saying, guys, you need to be assured and steadied in your faith. I'm going to do that with you. I'm going to mention to you. I'm going to impress on you that God has called you. And because of that, you're safe and you're secure in him to deal with the dreadful effects of tolerated sin in your life and in the life of your church. Whoever conceals their sins does not prosper, but the one who confesses and renounces them finds mercy. It's really important that we do this. You're going to be steady to be able to do it. He's knocking in a nail. You're called by God. Now let's do this. Because only when they're clear about God having set his love on them will they trust him to address their sin. And only in trusting him are they going to get the strength from him to deal with it. And they must. Or they're going to go down the pan. They've got history with God. Remember that, says Paul. He's called you. He's been real with you. He's called you. He gave you his grace and he called you, not just anybody. So this is the effective, not the general call. He's called you into fellowship with his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is therefore no distant myth to you, but the one that you've known, the one that you've had fellowship yourself with. And being reminded of that should be a source of assurance, building a perseverance strong enough to press on through the pain of necessary, needful repentance in the Corinthian church. You know, and I know, that he who conceals his sin doesn't prosper. But it ain't easy to pay the price to sort it through, to take that risk. Unless we are personally sure we're safe in Christ to do so. And the first thing we know, the first Christian experience we have that indicates to us that it is safe to walk with God is that he has called me to himself.